Greetings. I'm John McKirgan, Deputy Division Director in the Division of Engineering in the Office of Nuclear Regulatory Research, and I'm very pleased to welcome you to this session on molten salt reactors, rethinking the fuel cycle. The impetus for the session came from the NRC's recognition of the unique attributes of the molten salt fuel cycle, including novel fuel types and the potential for new waste forms. This session will elaborate on the different aspects and considerations of the molten salt reactor fuel cycle from a variety of perspectives. Next slide, please. Let me take a moment to set our stage for today. In the US, there are several reactor vendors pursuing a variety of molten salt reactor designs, both thermal and fast spectrum. Additionally, there are a variety of fuel and coolant types being considered, including both fluoride and chloride salts. As a safety regulator, the NRC doesn't advocate for any particular design or technology, but we do seek to be prepared to carry out our safety and security mission in light of whichever technology is submitted. The NRC staff is actively identifying molten salt reactor-specific technology areas that might warrant further assessment with regard to guidance. The NRC staff always encourages early engagement and pre-application activities, so any vendors there in the audience, please reach out early and often. We always welcome that engagement. To explore this topic, we've established a wonderful panel today. Next slide, please. Let me take a moment to introduce all our panelists. I'll go through the bios. They are available on the webpage if you'd like to read them later, but I'll run through them briefly here. I'll start with Dr. Raj Iyengar. Dr. Iyengar, currently the chief of the Reactor Engineering Branch in the Office of Nuclear Regulatory Research here at the NRC. He oversees the regulatory research activities in the areas of reactor vessel and piping integrity, probable fracture mechanics, non-destructive evaluation and inspection, and advanced reactor materials. Since 2009, he's held a variety of positions here at the NRC, including acting deputy division director, senior materials engineer, and technical assistant. Before joining the NRC, Raj has held corporate management positions in the automotive industry, where he led development and application efforts and research positions at Patel and the University of Pennsylvania. Raj holds a PhD in solid mechanics from Brown, an MS in mechanics and material science from Rutgers, and an MS in metallurgy from the Indian Institute of Science. Next, Dr. Patricia Pavier is the National Technical Director of the Molten Salt Reactor Program for the US Department of Energy, Office of Nuclear Energy, and the group leader of the Radiological Materials Group at Pacific Northwest National Laboratory. The DOE Molten Salt Reactor Program serves as the hub for efficiently and effectively addressing, in partnership with stakeholders, the remaining technology challenges for MSRs to enter the commercial market. Prior to joining PNL in 2018, she was the director of the Office of Materials and Chemical Technologies at DOE's NE, responsible for the R&D activities related to the back end of the nuclear fuel cycle. She is currently chair of the Gen 4 International Forum on Education and Training Working Group. She has more than 25 years experience on the back end of the fuel cycle and has worked as a professor, as well as in the commercial industry, and as a scientist and project lead for a number of laboratories. She obtained her PhD in radiochemistry from the University of Paris at Orsay. We also have Ed Files, a graduate of Penn State in fusion nuclear engineering. For 32 years, he's worked at the Naval Nuclear Laboratory, where he trained Navy personnel to operate nuclear reactors, help design, startup, refueling, test, maintenance, and decommissioning of 6 classes of US submarines, including the Virginia and Columbia classes, as well as the Ford class carrier. He helped start up 15 new and refueled reactors. Ed's designed and evaluated most advanced fuel cycle reactor types. He's helped the Jupiter Icy Moons Orbiter nuclear ion rocket for a 12-year mission to Ganymede, Europa, and Io, an adaptation of the reactor for moon-based power. Ed is the founder and chief technology officer of Releasium Industry, developing a fast chloride molten salt reactor. Next, we have Melanie Rickard. Melanie is the director of the Advanced Reactor Assessment Division at the Canadian Nuclear Safety Commission, with over 20 years at CNSC, and has held a variety of experienced positions in numerous facets of nuclear regulation, including the development and implementation of regulations, assessing compliance at nuclear facilities, and influencing the CNSC's planning for response to nuclear emergencies. Currently, she leads teams that carry out design assessments of advanced nuclear reactors, small modular reactors, and her team cooperates and collaborates with many other groups of scientists and engineers to to produce clear, accurate, and consistent technical assessments. For this work, as well as for other large complex projects related to nuclear safety, and she is enjoying the challenge of preparing for the deployment of SMRs in Canada. Melanie holds a master's degree in chemistry from the University of New Brunswick. And with that, I think we'll have a great session today. Let me make a few housekeeping remarks. We will be doing some live polling today, and we'll make an announcement as the questions come up and present those results and have a discussion towards the end of our session. There is a tab on your screen where you can enter questions. And then also next to that tab, there's another one for the polls, and that's where you'll see the polling come up. We will hold our question and answer segment at the end of the session after all the presentations. I do encourage you to enter your questions as they occur to you during the talks, and that will enable us to get them to the panelists, and I think we'll have some really good discussion. So that takes us to our first talk from Dr. Raj Iyengar, and his talk is Technical Considerations for the Molten Salt Reactor Fuel Cycle. So with that, I'll turn it over to Raj.
Thank you so much, John. Good afternoon to all of you. I'm quite excited today and honored to be part of this panel to discuss important considerations for molten salt reactor fuel cycle. Today, I'd like to share some insights on the technical considerations for the MSO molten salt reactor fuel cycle that gained by our capable and skilled staff. Before I proceed further, I want to acknowledge our staff who conducted a preliminary assessment, which we initiated a year ago. A former NRC staff, Ricardo Torres, who is now at PNL, for his vision in charting out a framework for conducting the technical assessment and potential intersections with the regulatory aspects. Jesse Carlson for his energy and enthusiasm to compile the necessary information. Wendy Reed for her exceptional technical and regulatory skills and experience. And certainly our colleagues from Nuclear Material Safety and Safeguards, Nick Hansing, and my friend Tom Boyce for proactively preparing the agency to assess advanced fuel cycle and sponsoring this important research effort. As I mentioned, NMSS or the office had been monitoring both the Department of Energy and industry activities related to potential licensing and certification of molten salt reactors, understanding the need to build our knowledge base and to assess potential technical challenges. Their office engaged with our office, research office, to conduct a preliminary assessment of the fuel cycle well over a year ago. To put our initiative in perspective, I wanted to mention that DOE, Department of Energy, ARPA-E program, which is Advanced Reactor, Advanced Research Projects Agency, established a program called CURIE to provide funding for R&D efforts on MSR fuel cycle. And Electrical Power Research Institute conducted a workshop on the back end of the fuel cycle. This all happened last fall after we had initiated this effort. So I just wanted to put a plug in for our researchers Be Ready mantra. The objective of our preliminary assessment was to better understand the potential technical and regulatory considerations related to the management of fuel of both fissile and fertile fuel materials for these near-term as well as potentially mid-term MSR technologies. We followed a time-honored procedure to conduct this assessment involving mining information related to prior operating experience of molten salt reactors and the associated fuel enrichment production and transportation operations, assessing current state of knowledge of fuel enrichment production and transportation options considered by various vendors, exploring technical issues and challenges related to the back end of fuel cycle, and then developing recommendations for our customer office for follow-on activities to support their initiatives related to licensing MSR fuel cycle. Next slide, please. Thank you. Our staff looked into mining prior operating experience. Yeah. And there's very little information. Oak Ridge National Lab has historically led efforts to support various MSR technologies. And they actually built two designs. One was the ATRAF reactor experiment established in 1949. at the request of Atomic Energy Commission, the fuel mixture of sodium fluoride and zirconium tetrafluoride was with sufficient uranium tetrafluoride added to the to make the reactor critical. The advanced the aircraft reactor project operated from November 1954 for a total of 96 megawatts. Now, the other one is a more well-known molten salt reactor experiments, which was an 8-megawatt thermal, a single fluid test reactor, which operated from 1965 to 1969. Both these were operated by DOE. Oak Ridge developed various techniques and procedures for preparing and handling molten salt since 1953. The molten salt production facility was operated in Oak Ridge Reactor Chemistry Division as an integral part of the molten salt reactor project. The facility operated, developed procedures, which some of it is available, including for handling operations, including fire, filling, sampling, and emptying engineering test loops. While a staff gained considerable insights regarding reactor operation, we did not mine much information on the from a fuel cycle perspective. There's limited information available on the transportation or the decommissioning of those reactors. Certainly there were no commercial transportation packages utilized, so we couldn't get that information. As NRC has no prior experience in regulating any aspects of the MSR fuel cycle. So in short, the staff did not gain significant insights from prior operating experience related to fuel cycle front and back end of the MSR technology. Next slide, please. I think there's a lag. Did you go to the next slide? Yes, okay. So there are two major considerations for the front end of fuel cycle of MSR. One is the enrichment, production, blending, and the other involving building and transporting the packages of fuel and salt materials to support offsite operations. These present distinct and distinct technical and regulatory challenges relative to uranium oxide-based fuels used in current light water reactor technologies. It's not a surprise. You will hear more on the technical details. I want to save all the technical details for Dr. Patricia Fabi. She's got a lot. So I want to save that for her and maybe save some time for a discussion. The fuel salt mixtures will be a combination of fissile and fertile materials of low enriched uranium, LEU, or either isotopic compositions. Fluoride salt reactors are expected to operate with uranium tetrafluoride and thorium fluoride. Similarly, chloride fuel salts are expected to operate on uranium trichloride in various chloride salts. Now, I wanted to go to most of the near-term technologies focus on these LEU, low enriched uranium, whereas some are looking into high SA, low enriched uranium. So there are, while centrifuge model is viable for LEU, and I want to note that in June 2021, the NRC approved a license amendment request for their American centrifuge plant to begin production of LEU in early 2022. On the high assay, low energy uranium side, DOE and its national laboratories are exploring various options for the production of HALEU fuel feed material, including electric chemical processing or hybrid zirconium extraction processes. These two are very new. They are not licensed. Those are reviewed. Those did want to mention that the NRC issued a report to Congress in December 2021, highlighting the flexibility of the current regulatory framework to accommodate licensing reviews related to value. Now, I do understand we have a regulatory framework which is flexible, but since these are new technologies and new considerations, we have to assess the technical challenges or considerations for which we need information data coming out of the vendors and DOE, Department of Energy. Many of the proposed methods of fuel salt enrichment involve considerations of production of uranium and thorium fluoride salts from source materials. And certainly, they involve various chemical reactivity hazards, which we as an independent regulator need to evaluate and assess those. So it is, while it's possible that increased enrichments of feed and fuel materials will need new safety analysis, but it certainly does not, we do have a regulatory framework that exists currently. On the transportation side, different approaches may be implemented for transporting. One consideration may be independent transportation of fissile and fertile fuel material and non-radioactive commercial salts to the reactor site facility where they can be mixed. There are multiple other considerations. Again, these all come, we have to do a licensing safety review under 10 CFR part 50, 54, or 53, depending on the type of approach used. Alternatively, we could utilize 10 CFR part 71 for approving transportation packages, if applicable. So the safe transportation of uranium tetrafluoride is not expected to involve new hazards relative to the transportation of hexafluoride. So that we did understand. So that's sort of a good news. So I want to highlight the front-end operations for near-term MSR designs will involve the management of materials without regulatory precedent, which will require safety reviews of different hazards, chemical hazards, as an independent regulator. However, we are engaged proactively to understand the technical issues and considerations for the front-end aspects so that we can provide timely decisions for the safety review. Next slide, please. The fluid fuel MSRs, those with fissile materials dissolved in the chlorine salt, will generate diverse mixture of waste streams, like John already alluded to. It's a fairly new to us, a novel. The full array of fission products is generally in the circulating fuel coal and salt. So the fission products can be loosely grouped into three categories, which can be soluble, or such as rare earth, or noble gas and noble metals. So we do need to understand the implications of these in terms and consequences of these. The three main categories of waste could be off-gas streams. Dr. Pavi is going to talk a lot about off-gas. This is fairly important. It's not only a back-end issue, it's also a licensing issue, as you will see from her discussions. The salt waste streams, which is, again, novel to us, and separating some of the more expensive isotopes that could be used, such as chloride 37 and lithium 7. We have to consider metal waste streams, carbon waste streams, and operating waste streams. So there are multiple considerations, and we are, our initial assessment pointed to some information. We would really be interested in getting more information data from all DOE national labs and other entities. Waste management will likely be, as John pointed out, will likely be unique to a particular design. So again, there is something, so we may have to also look into technology specific aspects. So while we can get a technology inclusive framework, we need to be looking into some technology specific aspect. Next slide, please. Now this picture you will see, the next slide is the waste forms. The waste forms need to consider compatibility with storage materials because these salts can be corrosive and mixture of fluorine salt can be even worse. So we need to be considering materials compatibility. While this is a sort of a low risk issue for storage, it could be different for these kind of salt storage, salt fluid storage. And long-term performance of waste form and canister need to be understood better. The dose management of some radionuclide will need to be considered, such as beryllium 10, for example, which is long-lived beta emitter with unknown environmental volatility properties. So there's few considerations, such as, and another one is a chlorine 36. Well, we have done a very good internal assessment, and we hope that'll pave the way for additional research activities with support of our partner office, NMSS. I did want to point one thing on the graphite waste. It looks like it may not be a issue, but we do need to understand the on-site storage of used graphite, because it might trigger some new forms that we're not of carbon we have not assessed, such as carbon 14. It's a large percentage of activity in graphite. It'll be in and on graphite. So these are things we need to understand better. I wanted to point out that while back end looks so far out, one might think, why is it important to consider that now? But in terms of these advanced reactor non-LWRs and molten salt, it's not just the back-end issue. Some of them are also in the licensing issue. So it gives us a holistic view of the entire fuel cycle that we're looking to. Next slide, please. Now, this is my summary slide. As we highlighted, MSR pose unique challenges. In both front end and back end, we are prepared to look into that and assess considerations. I also mentioned we have a flexible regulatory framework. While that may not be an issue, we need to know the technical issues involved. And NMSS and research are collaborating in future activities. And certainly, again, this is something you've heard multiple times from many people, and it sounds like a broken record, but I would say that it is important and that we have a continued and expanded engagement with Department of Energy, industry, and other entities in to learn and understand these issues better. Thank you so much, John.
Thank you, Raj. That's great. And that actually takes us to our first polling question. And so if I could ask for that question to come up, I'll read that for you. And again, that polling tab is off on the right side of your window, right next to the Q&A tab. And so please enter your questions as they come up. And our polling question, what do you see as the biggest challenges with regard to the front end of the MSR cycle? And so we look forward to hearing your responses there. And while you're doing that, I'll introduce our next speaker, Dr. Patricia Pavier. And Patricia's talk is on the fuel cycle of a molten salt reactor. So please take it away. Patricia, Raj set you up to cover a whole bunch of things. So please take it away.
Okay, thank you so much, John, for the introduction. And thank you, Wendy Reed, for inviting me to participate in this panel discussion. I think it's important. So. Today, I'm going to talk about the fuel cycle of a molten salt reactor. Understand that we have several concepts, so I may be completely wrong or kind of right. So next slide, please. So to set up the stage, you're going to see here where we are right now in the United States. It's a one-through fuel cycle. We have around 94 commercial nuclear reactors that produce every year 2,000 metric tons of spent fuel, 16,000 metric tons of depleted uranium. And we have around inventory of 84,000 metric tons of spent fuel and 750,000 tons metric tons of depleted uranium. Next slide, please. So the title of this slide is Molten Salt Reactor Renaissance. Yeah, maybe MSR can really contribute to the nuclear energy renaissance, because I think one significant potential of MSR, it's really improving the sustainability of the fuel cycle. So, which means that using more efficiently uranium, decreasing the amount of waste, and some of the concept we will use spent nuclear fuel into their reactors. As a reminder, a molten salt reactor is any nuclear reactor that employs a liquid halide salt to perform a significant function in core. As we said, we have so many concepts from the salt fuel to the salt cooled. We have two halides, the chloride and the fluoride, different fuel, uranium, thorium, plutonium, HA, LEU, LEU. We transuranic, we can have maybe spent fuel, and then the spectrum from thermal to far spectrum. As you see down below the screen, I put a few companies, and I will leave my colleague Ed, who will really go into more details with the different concepts. Next slide, please. Okay, so I am the National Technical Director of the Molten Salt Reactor Program for 1 year now. And again, our vision, it's really to be the hub to help these vendors looking at different technical challenges to really push for the MSR to enter the commercial markets. So we are four groups. The first one is looking at the salt chemistry. It's important to have the thermal properties of salt. The second group is looking at the technology development and demonstration, looking at radionuclide release, looking at sensor and instrumentation development. The third one focus on materials. So our really first, I will say, objective is to look at the gaps in the codes and the standard for the stainless steel 316H. And finally, we have a part with modeling, working with another company, which is called the Nuclear Energy Advance and Modeling Simulation. It's important for me to understand what are the different species in the region of a molten salt reactor. Next slide, please. So this is how I view a generic fuel cycle for a liquid fuel molten salt reactor. So I have color code because in the next slide you will see I put the yellow, the green like that. Hopefully you will remember this slide. But basically first, the most important is to salt, the synthesis of the salt, having, like I said, all the thermophysical, thermochemical properties in our hands. Then we're going to fabricate the fresh fuel salt. So we're going to use actinide, uranium, plutonium, thorium, different processes, chlorination or fluorination. And we will, some of the concept will use a potentially a spent nuclear fuel. And then everything will go into the reactor. So the difference with the molten salt liquid fuel is that we are going to release potentially some off-gas. So these off-gas need to be understood what are they, need to be trapped, and we need to have the right waste form. So you see the off-gas and then the waste. Depending on the concept, the liquid fuel molten salt reactor can be just thrown away. So that will be a spent salt fuel waste, or we can envision a salt processing to get rid of the accumulation of fission product, as an example, reusing the used fuel into the reactor. The fuel qualification also, as I noted here, is in my opinion very important. We really need to establish the rationale for the measurement ranges and the uncertainty. So for example, how pure the salt should be. That will depend on the vendors, that will depend on the on what they want to do. Also the uncertainties when we measure thermal properties, what is acceptable, because these properties are going to help us with the modeling. Next slide, please. So remember, first, the salt synthesis. So this campaign is focusing on the thermal properties of salt. This is very important. It's really something that has been asked by the vendors. As you can see, it's very small on my screen, but you have the fluoride and the chloride salt. And you see all these little boxes, white, with no colors or no letters. this is what we miss. So I have five national labs working on these thermophysical and thermochemical properties. It's very hard to have really a consensus again with the QA. It's very difficult to have a standard. Some key properties for the salt mixture being evaluated for use in the MSR have not been measured. We have a few values in the literature, but sometimes it's inconsistent, not suitable for use in licensing. So I refer to you the report from Bill Ebert and Melissa Rose from Argonne. That's the first part, the salt synthesis. Next slide, please. So now we're gonna go to the fuel synthesis. Oh no, before we have the thermochemical properties. That's a key, I will say, milestone for us. You have access now to our thermochemical properties database, as well as the thermophysical properties database. You have the link. We have fluoride and chloride salt content with different systems. For the thermophysical properties, we have entered data on melting temperature, boiling temperature, density, thermal conductivity, heat capacity, viscosity, along with the reference and the uncertainty. So I'm really extremely proud of this group that have been really able to release these databases. Next slide, please. So voilà, this is what I wanted to say before. So the fuel salt for an MSR is going to be a combination of the fissile salt, as an example, uranium fluoride, uranium trichloride, with a non-radioactive effluent or a carrier salt, fluoride salt, chloride salt. It's likely that the company producing the fuel salt will produce potentially the fissile salt, purchase the non-radioactive salt from a commercial sources, and then combine them to produce the fuel salt mixture. Depending on the MSR design, we may have also a fuel salt that contain fertile material for breeder MSR. And also, as I said before, we use of a spent light water reactor as a fuel. Next slide, please. So fuel qualification, again, very important. I am citing here for you all who are listening to me, the report from Dr. Dave Holcomb and his colleague from Oak Ridge National Laboratory. The fuel qualification is a process which provides the high confidence that the physical and chemical behavior of fuel is sufficiently understood so that it can be adequately modeled for both normal and accident conditions. So that's really crucial. Fuel qualification for me is crucial. Next slide, please. Okay, the gap. So when I prepare the slides, of course, you know, you have your brain thinking, and I saw Raj talking about the aircraft reactor experiments and the MSRE. But when you look at what we want to do, we are realizing that, oh, well, we do not have a large-scale fuel salt production facilities that has ever been built in this country. So that's one gap. And again, reference Johan McFarland report. Another one is the purification of your initial salt product. Depending on the concept, I would like to know what the salt, how the salt should be pure. Is it important or not? And then production of tonnage scale. Same question for the fuel salt, which will contact the 99, production at tonnage scale. Fuel qualification, again, no standard. We don't have centralized NQA1 program. And sometimes, like I said, the literature is inconsistent. And then Raj mentioned that the transportation of the salt from where it is fabricated to the reactor. So these are the gaps that we have to think about. Next slide, please. So we have our salt, we have our fuel, it's in the reactor, and puff, we're gonna have some off-gas. So we have regulation in this country, the EPA regulation and the NRC regulation. Unlike solid fuel, the liquid fuel salt does not retain significant quantities of gaseous fission product, thus increasing the release of the fraction of fission gases. So we have to take into consideration about that. The program is focusing right now on the xenon and on the iodine. And next slide, please. So you will see that we have leveraged some of the research that we already started 10, 15 years ago for reprocessing facility, looking, for example, as metal organic framework to capture xenon krypton, or looking at silica aerogel for iodine 129, not only to capture, but also to immobilize and have the right waveform. The greatest technical challenge that I see for the reactor developers will be in assessing off-gas performance during the reactor operations. Next slide, please. So right now, the scientists are working on the bench top in their laboratory. As you see, we have five national labs involved. My goal for next year is really to use a unique capability, the liquid salt test loop at Oak Ridge, for demonstrating this MSR monitoring system. So we will be able to use relevant powers, temperature, flow rates. And then the next time, the next step, I don't know if Tony Hill is listening to me, but Tony Hill is building at Abilene Christian University a test reactor. So I would love them, the next step, to use the sensors and the sorbent in a more realistic fashion to see how it's going to behave. Next slide, please. Waveform. So you saw the beautiful graphic done by Brian Wiley. So Brian is in my group, actually, at PNNL, and his colleagues. It's good, very good material. And I'm also citing, you don't see very well, but Joanne McFarlane from Oak Ridge, she has written a good report. Waste from an MSR is going to include those generating during the salt preparation, purification prior to re-addition, those generating during the operations, such as through sampling, analysis, online processing of gas, those generated at the end of the fuel cycling, fueling cycle, and then at the end of the operation of your nuclear reactor. You need to remember that many of the radiological hazards will be similar to those for operation of other nuclear power plants. Next slide, please. The storage. So storage is, I will say, crucial because MSR are a liquid, the liquid fuel, this is a liquid. So this is a different from what we have with light water reactor. It's going to become more problematic over the time. The current US regulation requires the ability to store the used fuel on site indefinitely in case we never have a deep geological formation for a repository. The halogen gas released from the used fuel salt during cooling is problematic. The high temperature tolerance of fuel salt will allow to be transferred to air-cooled containers, luckily without ever using a pool, so that's a good thing. We will have also radiolysis of fluoride-based fuel salt, which will result in fluorine gas, also in uranium hexafluoride fluorine gas. We can have chlorine-based fuel salt that do not have an equivalent with the uranium gas species, but will produce a chlorine gas. We need to think also to the chlorine 36, has a lifetime over 300,000 years, beta emitters, so that will require containment. I would like to point out DOENE has sponsored a development of the dehalogenation method for electrochemically processing the chloride salt, as an example, to allow for stabilization in an iron phosphate glass matrix and UCl3 to be suitable for incorporation into fresh fuel salt. So you see sustainability of the fuel cycle, trying to really close the fuel cycle. Next slide, please. So it's already the conclusion. I hope I'm on time. I know I have 15 minutes. So the MSR program, again, is here to really answer and help solve the technical challenges for MSR. It's important for us that they can enter the commercial market. I would like to cite really two ARDP risk reduction awardees, Kairos Power, which is with the Hermes test reactor. It's a reduced scale FHR Pebblebed test reactor being built in Tennessee, license application 2021, construction start 2023, operation 2026. So you see it's going fast. There's a strong momentum, a fast track. The Southern Company Services, also the recipients of this ARDP Risk Reduction Award, with the molten chloride reactor experiment, fast spectrum, integrated effect test facilities anticipated to be operational this year, provide data to support the development of TerraPower MCFR system. And then, I'm sorry, I have my notes. Yesterday, I was following the T9 session at the RIC, which is called Reimagine Nuclear World in Energy and the Electric Grid. There was a panelist, Mr. Arshan Mansour from EPRI. And voila, this is what he said. We expect in this decade to have a fully operational advanced molten salt reactor. So that's my conclusion, decade, 10 years. This is the booster, there's a momentum, and I really think that MSR could help for the sustainability of the nuclear fuel cycle and potentially closing the fuel cycle. So with that, thank you very much. And back to you, John.
My goodness, thank you. Thank you very much for that talk, that was wonderful. And I understand we may be having some challenges with the live polling, but let's see if we can bring up that next question just to get people thinking about that, or maybe I'll just I'll read the question. And really what we were gonna ask about was, what do you see as the biggest challenges on the back end of the fuel cycle? And so we wanted to understand both the front end and the back end. And so thank you. I think we'll move on to our next talk. I think that's Ed File, and his talk is on MSRs and closure of the LWR fuel cycle, turning liabilities into assets. So welcome, Ed, and please take it away. Ed, you have to unmute.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. So I'm going to mostly talk about the fuel cycle for the Elysium reactor to make sure that I'm not talking about proprietary stuff for someone else. Our goal was to try to solve a lot of the problems in the nuclear industry for this. Things like waste, what do you do with the waste? Answer those questions, passive safety, high temperature efficiency, and high temperature process heat. Do we have the slides?
Ed, perhaps you can proceed, and I'll reach back to the technicians to see if we can get your slides up for you.
Great. So one of the things of concern is that the largest part of the greenhouse gases for nuclear is in the mining and converting and enriching of the fuel. But in reality, we only see about maybe a third of a percent of the fuel actually being consumed in the reactor. So a lot of that energy is kind of being thrown away. So we thought it would be nice to actually use all of that so that we don't have to mine new fuel for every reactor core that we try to burn. So our goal is to try to close the fuel cycle. So we intend to use spent fuel recycle in a very simple manner. We're on slide 3. Right. So, and another goal is to eliminate the concerns about proliferation and indeed to consume weapons grade plutonium by denaturing it before we consume it. we want to have a target of $20 to $40 dollars per megawatt hour. We want to have passive safety. We don't want any meltdowns, and we don't want any chemical reactions that might be able to disperse fission products to the public. We want to have scalability and modularity. So our reactor is the same vessel from 10 megawatts thermal to 3000 megawatts thermal or 1200 megawatts electric. And we want a flexible operational environment. Our fuel is so low cost because we're using the waste and because we don't have to make it into solid fuel that you can literally make money by burning the waste and operate at full power and have just the turbines cycle for changes in power. And you're still economic in that case. One of the other things that drives up costs is refueling. So we do not take fuel out of the reactor for at least 40 years. And that essentially reduces the number of fuel handling evolutions by a factor of 10 over light water reactors. Next slide, please. So right now the US, has a nuclear waste management and disposition needs. We have about 80,000 metric tons, probably closer to 84,000 metric tons of stored nuclear fuel. There is 60 metric tons of weapons grade plutonium that needs to be gotten rid of. And we intend to denature that at a single startup fuel generation facility. And then there's another 700,000 tons or so of depleted uranium that can be used. Next slide, please. So we have three main types of fuel. The startup fuel, which our main target is for initial operations, is to take spent nuclear fuel and weapons grade plutonium and convert it to a chloride salt and have enough spent nuclear fuel in it with the low grade plutonium mixed with the weapons grade that it becomes denatured or less than 90% Pu-239, but also mixed with the spent fuel, which is uranium and fission products that will protect the plutonium. The second method of startup fuel production basically just takes spent nuclear fuel and essentially enriches the plutonium to 10 to 15% plutonium. That would have to be around 33% plutonium-239 in those. So that's already denatured. But basically what we do is we take uranium out of spent fuel until the plutonium gets up to the 10 to 15%. So we never remove all the fission products. We never remove all the uranium from it. So it's always still protected. And the third type is the feed-in fuel. So our startup fuel, we're going to make it a common facility in the United States near a facility that has a Category 1 security capability to make it with the weapons grade plutonium or to enrich it. But another section is to build a reactor at existing reactor sites where there is fuel and convert that fuel, just convert it from oxide to chloride without taking anything else out of it. And that's our feed-in fuel. Our feed-in fuel only needs about 3 kilograms per day to maintain the reactor. We don't, so if you think about it on a per year basis, a light water reactor adds about 25 tons of new fuel every year. We add 1 ton every year in our reactor. All we do is we change it to a chloride and then we feed in at 3 kilograms a day for 40 to 60 years, right? In order to eliminate the need for online processing or batch processing of the fuel over those years, we have a 1.04 breeding ratio to override the fission product poisons that build up. And then we don't have to take fission products out of the core either. And everything's uniformly mixed in the core. The waste streams that we see, excuse me, online is we have noble gases. And I think Patricia kind of already covered that. We intend to use the metaorganic frameworks to pull out separately the xenon and the krypton, and then separate with a centrifuge any gases like helium or tritium or hydrogen or deuterium, things like that. And the cover gas is argon, which gets fed back to the reactor. So it was just recycled online and then stored in the metaorganic framework, which is going to be at a low pressure. So that we don't have a concern over releasing high pressure materials, and we don't have a graphite material super cold fluids to try to trap the noble gases. We'd rather have them being able to be at whatever temperature they want to be without leaking out or having an accident of loss of cooling or loss of pressure. And then after 40 to 60 years, we'll purify the coolant, the fuel, by removing most of the short-lived fission products, the 100-year fission products. So that's one waste stream that we have, is 100-year fission products. And you'll say, well, usually people say that you have a 300-year fission products. Well, in our case, we intend to use the cesium and strontium to both lower the melting point over time and to protect the fuel from others handling it or theft. So it stays radioactive at all times, even after we've cleaned the fuel up and put it back in. So the 1.04 breeding ratio allows us to essentially take the fuel that comes out, take the short-lived fission products out of it, but then split the fuel in two parts to put it into two different reactors. So we've essentially doubled our fuel in about 50 years. Next slide, please. Oh, we've already tested this at INL. So we know it works. We've taken burned MOX and converted it into chloride. I'm sorry for the dog in the background. This is an example of a fuel conversion container. This is just one of the cases that we're doing, and I'll talk through it as if it were making the feed-in fuel. This is basically a shipping container for processing. The fuel cell gets put in on the left, the ends are cut off of it, and then it's raised up, and then 1 centimeter at a time is cut off and dropped into a vat, which has carrier salt in it. All right, the two of the carrier salts is sodium chloride and potassium chloride, and then the third salt mixed in will steal the oxygen out of the system and replace it with chlorine, and the oxygen then becomes a particulate. So this is a single chemical process for converting spent nuclear fuel oxides into fast chloride MSR fuels. We just need the one step. So normal pyroprocessing is 6 or 7 steps, and we've reduced it to 1, and we don't remove things like fission products or the uranium or anything like that in this process. But as I said, there's particulates, there are fuel cladding for zirconium. That is removed and recycled into the light water reactor fuel cladding business. And the other particulates are captured, like the oxides and some of the noble metal fission products are captured. And then the fuel is over at the right-hand blue section. That is where the fuel goes through as a liquid. It's cooled and cut into 1 kilogram of actinide sections and put into a fuel handling cask. And from the fuel handling cask, it goes into the reactor. And as I said, you put in about 3 kilograms a day to keep the reactor. And in our case, the reactor gets fed fuel when you need to raise the temperature back up to peak temperature, because over time, as you burn out the uranium and burn in fission products, the temperature will tend to drop. So you just add fuel for it. And it will have an argon cleaning system as well. So the startup fuel version of this is the black sections in the center. So this is a feed-in fuel section, is the part that I just described, but if you add plutonium in or plutonium oxide, you can turn it into startup fuel. So the goal is to have everything modularized like this in individual shipping container size boxes. And then if you need to make more like startup fuel, then you would just get more of these boxes for making more fuel at a higher rate. This is able to do about a 1 ton a year type rate. So you would need a lot of these for doing startup fuel. We hope to get that up faster, but the 1 ton a year is kind of based on 1 ton a year of the fuel that you need for the feed-in fuel for our reactor. So we end up using a tiny fraction of the fuel that a light water reactor, for instance, uses. And we get about 30 times as much energy out of the spent nuclear fuel for doing this. So next slide, please. This is just an example of us basically saying, we want to go to where there are already other reactors and build on the same site, a facility, like on the right, at that reactor and consume the spent fuel on site from that reactor without having to transport it to another facility. The stuff that actually gets transported to another facility for places where the reactor doesn't exist anymore would go to a consolidated interim storage facility, and that's where we would build our startup fuel production capability, because there's more fuel going to be at those locations. Next slide. Great. So I'd like to thank you, but basically, I guess what I'm saying is the goal here is to take the light water reactor fuel and eliminate that as a long-term waste material. And the only waste that we're going to end up having is 100-year fission products that have to decay and the noble gases that have to decay out of that. So thank you very much.
Ed, thank you. Thank you very much for that that talk. That was wonderful. And I do apologize to everybody who had some challenges with the polling, and we're going to see if we can get that back in operation, and maybe we can run through that at the end of our Q&A session. But let's move on to our next talk from Melanie Rickard, and her talk is A Regulatory Perspective on the Impact of Molten Salt Reactors. So thank you for coming in, and take it away, Melanie.
I also just wanted to take a note to say I'm the president's birthday with my dog. So with my dog, that's unexpectedly so let's just dive right in here, taking a little bit of a different approach here, bringing some regulatory perspective to SMC with regards to SMRs in general, some specifics on molten salt reactors, with regards to the impact of the fuel cycle. Next slide, please. So first, just a very brief introduction to the CRC for those of you who may not be familiar. We are a science-based regulatory organization, and we regulate to prevent unreasonable risk to the environment, the health, and safety of people, and atmosphere. The CNSC is the authority in Canada that regulates the development, production, and for energy and production and use of nuclear substances, prescribed equipment, prescribed information, and prescribed information rather in order to prevent unreasonable risk. Next slide, please. So our regulatory our regulatory approach is founded on several key principles, which are some of which are listed on this slide. Fundamentally, being objective and independent in our decision-making and oversight is key. It is the foundation for building public trust and confidence in science. Safety is paramount in all that we do in the nuclear sector for both us and the industry, and it is the licensee's responsibility to ensure the safety of their operations. We review the safety cases that are before us, and ultimately we make recommendations to our commission on whether or not an applicant should be granted a license. Getting some messages about breakup. Apologize for that. For new and innovative technologies, it's helpful for the regulator to start its work early to be fully prepared in order to execute our mandate. And so we've established a number of pre-licensing activities in order to execute this work, in order to prepare for the future work. Next slide, please. So this is a bit of a busier slide, and obviously there's no expectation for you to take all of this in now, but certainly we can do it later. The purpose of this slide is just to show the different stages in our licensing process, as well as our licensing activities, our pre-licensing activities. It's really just to illustrate that there are several steps involved in this transparent decision-making process. For SMRs, we have received one application for a license to prepare site from Global First Power. This is regarding the Ultra-Safe Nuclear Corporation. The Ultra-Safe Nuclear Corporation's reactor to be deployed at the Chopper Laboratory site. And we are aware, and I'm sure the audience is aware as well, that OPG has recently announced that they will be submitting an application for this year for a license to construct the GBWRX-300 reactor. Assessments of some design specifics for both of these reactors, the MMR and the BWRX-300, are being done for the VDR process, which is illustrated on the left-hand side of this slide, just in a lower red bubble. And this process will be elaborated on in a few moments. Just gonna take a really quick break, John. How am I coming through verbally? I'm seeing some text messages. Is it clear? Can you hear me well?
It was breaking up there for a moment, but I think it's audible now, so thank you.
Okay, I do apologize for that. Carrying on. The CNSC's experience with SMRs has been informed by a number of diverse activities. So as I mentioned, we have been involved in vendor design reviews, and we've completed several of those over the span of more than a decade. The VDR is no assurance of a future regulatory approval, but it does give us an early indication of any potential fundamental barriers to licensing. The work that we have done with regards to SMRs has taught us that we do not have all the answers. We therefore regularly engage with international colleagues to share information and insights. Can I just do a check that we are on slide number 6? I believe we are. Slide number 6, entitled CNSC's Experience with SMRs. Thank you very much. I'm returning now to my notes. So we do engage internationally with colleagues in order to share information and insights through our respective reviews to try to address gaps or complement our work. We have developed strong relationships with other countries. And notably in 2020 and 2019, we have signed MOCs with the ONR, the UK ONR, and US NRC. In the last year, we have had great success. We've completed a couple of projects, and we've made progress on other projects that we are working on. And we very much look forward to future successes with both of these organizations. Reviews conducted by multiple mature and respected regulators under these arrangements that include that designs or design processes are viable, and that we have no reservations with potentially licensing an applicant of a particular technology should provide insight to other nuclear countries, particularly nuclear newcomers. So it's all of the above that I've just described that has influenced our perspective on the impact of SMRs on the fuel cycle from a design, processing, safeguards, and waste management perspective. Understanding that all of these aspects are interrelated. And this is what I'm going to focus on during the rest of my presentation. Next slide, please. So now it appears I'm on slide 6. Sorry for the confusion. So first, regarding design aspects. As mentioned, we do vendor design reviews, and for those in the audience that may not know what this is, it is an optional pre-licensing process where vendors and designers engage with the CNSC under a contract. We call it a service agreement. The review is an opportunity for both the CNSC and the vendor, where the CNSC provides feedback on the vendor's efforts to address Canadian regulatory requirements and identifies fundamental barriers to licensing, if any, early in the process. The VDR covers a number of objectives and covers off a number of selected focus areas, actually 19 in total. And if problems are noted early in these areas, there is time for the vendor to resolve them before they become potential licensing issues, if and when a license application is to be received by an applicant. These technical areas, focus areas, range from highly technical, such as core and fuel design, to cross-cutting programmatic areas, such as research and development and management systems. The review is carried out independently by CNSC staff with no involvement of the commission member panel. And the process is also independent from the CNSC's licensing regime. Next slide, please. So currently we're working with two organizations, two designers specifically, regarding VDRs. We're looking at both their design and their design processes as part of that, specific to molten salt reactors. So Terrestrial Energy Incorporated has completed phase one of their VDR, and they are currently working near completion of their phase two. Moltex completed a phase one review in 2021, and has signaled intention to commence a phase two for its stable salt reactor. To learn more about the conclusions of these vendor design reviews, please see our website. We do post an executive summary at the end of every project so that the public and our stakeholders can get a sense of what our conclusions and findings were. Next slide, please. So in part, based on VDRs, CNSC staff have noted that there are areas, of course, that require further evidence and data in order to support the design and safety case. These relate to, for example, evidence that materials associated with the structures, systems, and components can withstand the very high temperatures involved, and that there are reliable ways to monitor certain plant parameters. And some of these techniques, for example, will involve the development and testing of sensors that will be immersed in these salts. The evidence that is required, though, in order to support all the claims is the responsibility of the design organization and future applicants and licensees. There is a lot of research going on at these institutions, at other research institutions in Canada, and as you've heard, abroad as well, in order to close the gaps that do exist. Next slide, please. So let's talk a little bit more now about what's happening at the front end of the fuel cycle. This map illustrates the current distribution in Canada of our front end facilities with our uranium mines and mills that are located in Saskatchewan. And on the processing side of the cycle, we do everything from refinement, conversion, and fuel fabrication. And those facilities are all located in Ontario, which is shown in a cutout here on the left of the slide. Please note that there is an error, a geographical error in the map on this slide. The pins on the cutout have shifted. So those facilities appear to be in Quebec. They are very much not in Quebec. The facilities are indeed in Ontario. Next slide, please. So as SMR concepts and proposals advance in Canada, there's a lot of discussion, and some of which was already brought up today, about novel extraction and reprocessing methods that are associated with the spent fuel. New Brunswick Power, for example, is working with one molten salt reactor designer, Moltex, in exploring reprocessing spent fuel. And this proposal is in the very preliminary phases with a letter of intent that has been received by the CNSC on this matter. Canada does not have any prior experience with domestic reprocessing at this time. And as such, preliminary discussions around Canada's waste policy have begun. No matter what transpires, any future reprocessing activities must comply with Canada's nuclear non-proliferation policy, our regulatory requirements at the CNSC, and our international commitments. Now, regarding the second bullet on this slide, liquid-based fuels are novel, as you all know, in many ways, but in terms of fuel salt manufacturing proposed in some MSR designs, questions surrounding the process, where it will be done, and implications on potential transport of such material do come into play. Under the MOU that I referred to at the beginning of this talk, the CNSC and NRC have recently started specific cooperative activities related to the front end of the advanced reactor fuel cycle, as well as related transportation issues. Lastly, the supply chain for high-assay, low-enriched uranium fuels that are being proposed as part of some designs has not yet been made clear, and a path forward for this fuel source will need to be determined if these designs are to progress towards licensing and future operation. Next slide, please. Adherence to Canada's international safeguards commitments are, of course, fundamental to our regulatory oversight so that nuclear materials are not used for nuclear weapons purposes. The CNSC supports the concept of safeguards by design for all designers. And in terms of some specifics associated with molten salt reactors, there are, of course, some challenges regarding safeguarding of bulk nuclear material in the form of molten salt versus the traditional solid fuel bundles that we're accustomed to dealing with here in Canada and abroad. So those issues are related to material accountancy and verification. And that's being worked through now as part of our design review, and certainly as these designs may move towards licensing, there will be some advancements in this area. The CNSC is a participant in an IAEA member state support program task on safeguards by design for small modular reactors, which aims to identify the key technical challenges and safeguards implementation, challenges for safeguards implementation, and the steps that can be taken to support safeguards by design principles into these designs. Any SMR built in Canada will have to entail a comprehensive safeguards approach that is acceptable to the IAEA. Next slide, please. One quick moment, everyone. I just lost a slide somehow. I will quickly pull that up. Thank you. So now just to do a check, I'm on a slide that is entitled Waste Management. So finally, let's turn to the back end of the fuel cycle in terms of the management of spent fuel. In Canada, safe and secure management of waste is a national priority, and waste producers and owners are ultimately responsible for the management of their waste. This is following requirements set out by the CNSC and also in line with any applicable national or international standards. At this time, when it comes to long-term storage of spent fuel, Canada continues to work on strategy with a vision that by 2050, key elements of Canada's radioactive waste disposal infrastructure are in place. And planning is well underway for the remaining facilities necessary to accommodate all of Canada's current and future radioactive waste. The Nuclear Waste Management Organization is the organization responsible for developing a solution for the long-term management of waste in Canada. The advancement of SMRs has meant that new forms of waste and new fuel waste owners, or new waste owners rather, are being considered. And as such, the NWMO has been engaged with these vendors in order to lay the groundwork to ensure that they are included in these plans. I'd like to conclude this part of the presentation by noting that Canada is currently modernizing its nuclear waste policy on radioactive waste management and decommissioning under the umbrella of NRCan, has sought feedback from our stakeholders, and so this policy is evolving as we speak. Next slide, please. So just to summarize, the CNSC is ready to regulate SMRs and is increasing our readiness activities in order to perform both effective and efficient reviews in a timely and safe manner. As you heard, our experience is informed by a number of different activities, processes, and relationships, including a number of important bilateral relationships that we have with both the NRC, the US, and the UK. Through these activities, it is apparent that SMRs, including molten salt reactors, present some challenges and opportunities. But the CNSC's risk-informed approach allows for the regulation of these non-traditional reactors. And with that, I would like to thank my audience, particularly for your patience with some of the hiccups that I experienced during the delivery of this presentation. And with that, I thank you for your attention, and I will pass it back over to you, John. Thanks very much.
Melanie, thank you. Thank you very much. And thanks to all of the panelists. Some wonderful information. I really appreciate your presentations. We have a number of questions. It was clear that this was a very interesting topic, and we received a number of questions. I think far more questions than we have time to answer, but I did want to run through some of them, and we've tried to gather them into some themes. This first question I'd like to give to Raj. Raj, if you could. We got questions along the lines of what the NRC is doing to prepare for SMR or molten salt reactor technologies. I wondered if you could give your thoughts on that.
Oh, certainly. And I totally appreciate this question. I believe that question not only related to the front end or in reactor operations, but also the back end, and in particular the back end issues. So as you know, we have done a good assessment of molten salt reactor technologies and identified gaps and regulatory considerations for operations. We have embarked on this initiative right now, which has been a year now, proactively looking at the front end considerations and as well as back end. Now I will tell you the back end is when, you know, we understand everybody's enthusiastic about front end because it has to happen in terms of licensing space. We all want to know about the operations because that's important. The back end is left to the back end normally, but in this case, because of the variety of types and different issues that we have not really tread along. It is important for us to have this engagement. As you know, this today is our presentation is the first assessment we have done, and Patricia Pavie added a lot of great information. So I do think this extended coordination, collaboration with entities such that we are still have to be independent, maintain independence, it's very critical, especially for the back end. I mentioned about off-gas. Off-gas, there are a lot of issues, and Dr. Andrew Reed can talk to you a lot about that. And these are all handleable because we need to, before that, we need to understand the issues and see how they can be addressed and fit within the regulatory framework that we have, or is it something that we need to revise? So I think early engagement, pre-application activities that NRC encourages a lot with the specific vendors, and then research. My office, I'm saying we have a lot of coordination and collaboration with various entities, DOE, Electrical Power Research Institute, international regulators. So those are all, we all have to have all of those checked. Thanks, John.
Thank you. Thank you, Raj. Ed, I might turn this next question over to you. There was a question about your thoughts or insights on safeguarding the material at your sites, and in particular, how control and accountability and inventory of the special nuclear material would be handled. And perhaps one of the other panelists might want to speak on that too, but I'll start with you if I could.
Okay, so initially you have to think about a fast chloride MSR a little bit differently, because we don't have a waste stream that comes out that ends up getting stored. As a matter of fact, we consume safeguardable material of spent nuclear fuel and weapons grade plutonium and consume it. So we are actually improving the safeguards picture in respect to light water reactor and the excess weapons material. So that makes it a little bit different. The reactor doesn't take fuel out for 40 to 60 years. So you think of a light water reactor taking fuel out every 18 months or so. We don't do that for 40 to 60 years. So there's not a lot of access to it. But as far as actually monitoring the content of the reactor, we will have isotopic and elemental measurements of the contents of the fuel salt. One benefit is it's all integrally mixed. And we also measure the volume, because in actuality, we put in more fuel, or at least 50% as much fuel over the years as we started with. So we end up with an extra like 40 or 60 tons of fuel in the reactor by the end of life. So we monitor both the volume and the elemental and isotopic content of that fuel. And then when it's taken out, it stays mixed. Our purification system doesn't remove uranium separate from plutonium. So it always stays mixed, and it will stay mixed with cesium and strontium as well. So it's still protected as fuel in the purification facility, which there's only one of those purification facilities. The fuel would be shipped from the reactors to a central facility for purification, which would be licensed for handling fuel as a fuel production facility would be, in the same similar amounts of controls as the United States has done in the past of pyroprocessing or Purex processing. So it's kind of more like a fuel production plant in its safeguards controls than it is of an actual reactor, because we don't do it very often.
Thank you. Thank you, Ed. I wondered if any of the other panelists wanted to comment on that. Patricia.
Yes. I'm going to talk for Ben CPT. Ben CPT is the National Technical Director for Advanced Safeguard for the reactors in DOE and E5. I would like to say that they are developing online monitoring tools to monitor uranium and plutonium, looking also at the different composition of the salt. So safeguard by design is a big topic in this advanced reactor safeguards campaign.
Thank you. Thank you, Patricia. And while I have you, maybe I'll get your thoughts on this this question. The question was, you know, while we say molten salt reactor, there are really several different reactor technologies based on salts and fissile isotopes, et cetera. Could you give your thoughts on the risks associated with that diversity?
You know, at the end of the day, there will be certainly just a few concepts that that will emerge. That is, depends on if I think, for example, uranium, plutonium, or thorium. Right now, in this country, a lot of us, I will say, capabilities have been developed for uranium and plutonium. So it may be more difficult for the thorium, even though we have companies that are developing the thorium fuel cycle. So that could be an issue. Then we have, of course, depending on the concept, the fuels, that's a high risk. Which fuel you're going to use? Some of them are going to use HALEU. Are we going to have enough HALEU? It's another risk. And then you look at the waste that is produced. Some of the concepts will have I call that spent fuel salt waste without thinking to nothing. Okay, you have your salt with your fuel inside and you throw that somewhere and oh well, the next generation will think about that. No way, you cannot do that, you know. So that's for me the high risk. We need to think to the entire fuel cycle. I'm very happy to have this panel to start thinking and having the people thinking about looking at the entire fuel cycle, not the reactor only, but the front and the back end. So these are the high risk that I see. That's the reason we have a lot of research done on this subject.
If I might comment here, one thing you have to think about with liquid fuels is there are as many or more types of liquid fuel as there are solid fuel reactors. So it's an entire, you know, doubling of the category of fuel types that we have to understand.
Indeed. Thank you. Thank you. This is, it's a rich area. Melanie, if I could, it looks like Canada is currently addressing some of these issues. And we got a question, if you could elaborate on the regulations being used for the current design reviews in Canada.
Absolutely. Thank you for the question. So in terms of future licensing, and for that matter, current licensing, since we do have some license applications with us, so we certainly have one regarding Global First Power, there are a number of regulations that apply. So we do have regulations for class one facilities, which apply here. We have radiation protection regulations. We have regulations that relate to waste management, et cetera. So those regulations would apply, but I think the question is probably more focused on the work that we're doing right now with our design reviews. So I'll sort of shift and focus on that a little bit for a moment. In terms of design expectations or requirements related to design, we have one rather key document that is called Reg Doc 252. You can find it on our website. And that covers off our design expectations. And so that is the document that really guides our review and certainly guides our designers in terms of their VDR. We also have a couple of really key documents related to safety analysis. So both deterministic and probabilistic safety analysis that come into play as well. Those are numbered 241 and 242. So as I mentioned, those are the main ones. We also have a series of license application guides that are available for licensees. And 112 and 115 are the numbers for those license application guides that are more specific to helping future applicants sort of find their way in terms of what CNSC expectations are regarding the licensing process. And I will say one thing, just since I have the microphone and hopefully people can hear me. The document that we have, 252, is, like if you look at the preface, it does speak about water cooled reactors, because a lot of our experience, of course, has been based on water cooled reactors. But we really feel that this document is fit for purpose for SMRs because it utilizes a graded approach. We also accept alternative approaches. So with those two things in mind, 252 does seem to be quite appropriate for reviewing SMRs, recognizing that in the future we may need to make modifications or additions, what have you, in order to accommodate some of the specifics of some of these SMRs. Thank you for the question.
Melanie, thank you for that. And I know we're running a little short on time, but I wondered if we could take just a moment, and my apologies to everyone for the challenges we had with the polling. But I was very interested to see, I think we did get some results on that last polling question about the regulatory challenges, if we could flip to that for a moment. And I'd like to just open this up to the group. I'll give you just 2 seconds, unfortunately, to digest that slide. And if I could just go quickly through the group and if you could offer your thoughts, I'll start with you, Raj. Is there anything, it looks like a fairly even distribution. I don't know if you have any reaction to the results there for this, the challenges that we're facing. And I'll ask you to come off mute first.
Thanks, John. No, I'm not surprised at all. It's such an even split. And I want to tell you, we are checking mark on A, B, and A, C, and D, And regarding the consensus codes and standards, I don't know how much, I mean, we know in operations we have codes and standards that are, you know, being considered, but this is something, a good idea to probably explore for the technical community and DOE. Thanks.
Thank you, Raj. I'll just quickly just look to the other panelists to see if anybody else wants to offer any perspectives on those results. So with that, I think we are coming to the end of our time. I do want to thank the panelists, of course, for their wonderful presentations. This is clearly an area that there's a rich amount of work that has already been done and rich work that is still yet to be done. I again have to put in the plug to any vendors or licensees out there. The NRC does always welcome pre-application engagement early and often. As you can see, there's a huge diversity of technologies embedded in this area. And so engagement with regulators is encouraged and welcomed. I also want to take a moment to thank some of our supporting staff, Wendy Reed and Jesse Carlson, and of course, all of our IT support. I know we did have some challenges today, but I think we worked through them and had a very productive session. And so with that, I will thank you all and declare this session completed, and hopefully you all enjoy the rest of the RIC. So thank you very much and have a great day.